Hi, I'm Roger Sutton. I'm the boss at CERA. Winter is clearly here, and winter always brings a whole lot of health issues. So I'm here today with a group of people who are passionate about these issues, who've got some expertise, people drawn from around Canterbury. So first of all, on your right is David Mates, who runs the Canterbury District Health Board, Mark Thomas from the Fire Service, and Sheila Hailstone from Community Energy Action. So starting off with you, David. Winter's here, everything's cold, everything's wet. Admissions to hospital are coming up. How's it all going?
We've seen the last 3 weeks the hospitals right across Canterbury running pretty full all of the time. Prior to the last 3 weeks, what we've been seeing is patterns of spikes during a week where the hospital gets full and then admissions seem to fall away. But certainly the last 3 weeks we're now running pretty much at full capacity all of the time. And one of the real concerns we've got is that already in this last 12 months we've managed about 19,500 people in the community setting that if they were anywhere else in New Zealand they would have been hospitalised. So the concerns about homes, heating, safe environments are really, really important for us to be continuing to focus on to ensure that we're minimising the ongoing pressures that are going to face us through this winter.
So what happens? Why are you full? What are these people suffering from?
Well, interesting enough, the snow a few weeks ago, a lot of fractures came in with that, and that was certainly an unexpected element. But certainly as the winter setting upon us, a lot of respiratory type of illnesses. And we are seeing a wee bit of an increase in some of the cardiac pressures, just slowly building up over the last few months. And going back to the September 2010 earthquake, we had a massive spike in cardiac issues sitting there, and that quake probably did a favour to a lot of people that were thinking about having a heart attack. They had one. And as a consequence, we've then been pretty flat since then, but we are starting to see just a wee bit of an increase starting to emerge again.
In terms of these sort of winter sort of health issues, the flus and all that, what can we do to keep ourselves out of bed and I guess eventually out of your places?
Well, one of the most effective interventions that actually as a community to help help prevent a health service or health system overflowing is to get vaccinated. Flu vaccination is still one of the most effective ways of removing the risk of illness. And particularly those over 65 years of age, those that have got chronic conditions, and those that are under 18 years of age. And we're focusing very heavily on those under 18 in terms of free flu vaccination. And the reason why the under 18 year olds are so important is that they tend to group in schools and universities. We get a lot of young together. They're a great incubator for spreading influenza.
The warmth thing? Are we seeing issues just because people aren't keeping themselves warm?
One of the some of the core elements in terms of people keeping themselves warm in homes, we do know, and there's a lot of evidence that once the temperature drops beneath about 16 degrees in a home, it's a strong correlation with a lot of underlying illness sitting around that. So it is really important that people are keeping their homes warm. If there are issues with heating homes, dressing warmly, particularly with woolen clothes and the like, and eating well. And the other bit is if people are not well, not to sit at home and
getting
not doing
worse.
Something about it. Go to your general practice. Go and see a health professional to get on top of it and to do it sooner rather than later. And I think the other element too is one of the things immediately after the quake, I think the city became a bit of a softer and kinder place. Everyone started reintroducing themselves to neighbours and the like. And now more than ever, the importance of just checking on your neighbours, particularly the elderly. Are they okay? Have they got support structures in place? And making sure that members of our community, particularly the vulnerable, are not feeling or getting isolated.
The staying warm stuff, Sheila. Community Energy Action has been around for a long time.
17 years.
17 years, yeah. Working in the community.
That's right.
Trying to keep people warm. What messages would you have to try and stay warm at home? Well, how do you think about these issues?
Well, we do think about the temperature. I think it's very important and suggest that people have their living rooms around the 18 to 21 degrees, particularly if they are vulnerable to health issues, around the 21 degrees for their living rooms, and not let their bedrooms get below 16 degrees. I mean, we've got problems with respiratory issues and cardiovascular issues if you start letting your house temperature drop below that. So, of course, that begs the question, how do you keep your house warm? You know, what do you do? It's a bit like putting the hat, woolly hat on your head or whatever. Make sure your insulation is up to standard in your house.
So insulation, there's still a government program where you can get subsidies for insulation?
There is, yes, still a Warm Up New Zealand program. We're service providers for this, bona fide people who make sure that the insulation is put in correctly.
So that's a program where, it's if you're a low income, if you've got a community services card, how big is the subsidy there?
60% for low income, and there's also still subsidies available for those on a general income as well. Makes a huge difference. And of course, we as we know in Christchurch full well at the moment, we live in quite a damp city. There's no doubt about that. And it's amazing the difference having that polythene moisture barrier makes under houses as well to keeping that house nice and dry.
So you're talking about insulating the roof,
yes.
Insulating under the floor.
Correct.
But also polythene barrier, which is going to stop the moisture and any liquefaction issues under the house, that's going to help.
What a difference that can make to people, and really can make their houses drier. And that's all about what we're talking about, making the home dry as well, because any dampness can exacerbate those health issues, particularly respiratory issues.
If people don't have even the money to pay for, you know, the subsidy isn't enough, are there other people who will help with some of those costs as well, Sheila?
Well, that was the whole point of Community Energy Action Trust. Our whole remit is about fuel poverty, helping people with those issues, and we have extra subsidies available. We have special charitable programs like the Elderly Health Program, the Warm Babies Program as well. So we're there to help people.
So if people have got one of those things, they can get in touch with you?
Absolutely, yes. 0800 Get Warm.
the other area around, we can talk about the heating at the moment, but insulating our houses. Mm. Stopping drafts, is there anything you think around draft stopping and those sort of things? Because that's, our house is full of cracks and holes at the moment. And right. The other night I slept in a room when the kids were sick and there was a hole in the wall and it was grim.
I will agree, and terribly grim for a lot of people, no doubt about that. The earthquake has exacerbated this.
So if you want to find those cracks, you want to get those cracks fixed, who does that sort of stuff?
Well, we'll go 0800 to get warm. But other than that, you know, the issues that you've got to think about with getting warm, have a look at your windows, number one. Have you got curtains? Yep. Those curtains thermally backed? Something very simple to make sure, you know, open up in the day, let the sun in when the sun's shining, close it in the evening, to make sure you trap that heat in, make sure the curtains are closer to the wall if possible, get a certain track that goes across,
yep,
to make sure the air doesn't come out.
So you want it's like a real seal against the window.
A seal is the idea, or even just a piece of thin wood across the top can make a difference for people. If you haven't got curtains, again, Community Energy Action Trust runs a recycle curtain bank, so we can provide those thermally backed curtains for you as well at no cost for those in the lower socioeconomic
group. I guess that's also a message for people watching. If you've got curtains,
yes,
give them to you and you'll actually make sure they're recycled and used properly.
Yeah, and to thank a lot of people out there, because a lot of people have really thought about us when they've had to leave their own homes and leave behind curtains, and they've really thought about Community Energy Action and doing good for the rest of Christchurch. So particularly a big thank you to those people.
So hopefully we've now got a house which is insulated, we've fixed some of the drafts.
Yes.
Heating it. Do you want to talk quickly about the heating options and then we can talk about how we make sure the house doesn't catch fire.
That's right. Well, of course, the energy efficient option, heat pumps, because you obviously, for what you put in, you get more energy out in that way. People are able to use their log burners at the moment. If it's one that is due to be decommissioned, if it's older, again, there are big subsidies for that and great help in that way.
So
as
the
well.
One information on those sort of on those heating options, they can talk to you guys as well?
Again, they can talk about the options that are there.
Okay. So, just generally with safety in winter, you know, keeping warm, we have fires and those sort of things, Mark. Are we seeing more fires, do the rates of fires go up in winter? What causes that?
Your fire rates do go up in winter, but they're a different type of fires. Obviously, where people are warming their homes, they have to do it with some form of heating. The first one I'd like to talk about, and Sheila brought it up, was wood burners and open fires for that matter, is the disposal of ash. People will take their ash out, and look, so many times in the winter we will end up going to a fire in their woodshed or in their wash house or on their back porch, where they have taken the ash from the fireplace, believing it to be cold, and put it out there in a flammable container, a plastic bucket or a cardboard box. And 2 days later, even.
Stuck in the rubbish bin, maybe, and the rubbish bin's up against the house.
Exactly. And we see that time and time again. Look, the recommendation is that you should, ash will not be cooled for at least 5 days. And if you're taking it out, it should be removed in a non-flammable container, something like a metal container. And if you're going to store it outside, away from the house, because even the metal will transfer the heat through to the side of a house.
Other tips in terms of, you know, I mean, we've got, so if you've got a wood burner, you've clearly got some issues there. Other issues around using heaters and those sort of things?
Oh, absolutely. We have a little saying that we call it the meter heater rule. And that is a rule that we suggest nothing that is flammable, including people, should be any closer than 1 metre from any form of heating. I can remember my son coming downstairs in his boxers and his T-shirt and hugging the heater when we were in our previous home, and I was forever growling at him. People are also flammable. Keeping things at least a metre away from a heater, if you're drying clothing inside, does give you the probability that they won't go on fire. So that's a very important aspect of the heating of the home. Another thing that I'd like to talk about a little bit is the odd forms of heating that some people are having to resort to. We've heard anecdotally of people bringing a barbecue into the home and using that for heating. And a barbecue and the wee cabinet gas heaters both have the open flame, obviously. But as Sheila mentioned earlier, they also do tend to give off an awful lot of...
Horrible fumes.
You're getting carbon monoxide, which a couple of years ago, there were several people in the North Island died in this situation with a barbecue inside a hut. And also, when you are burning LPG, you're burning off water vapour, and that's why the homes become so damp inside and the windows become drenched in condensation.
So I would have thought also a barbecue is actually much worse than a gas heater, because at least a gas heater has been designed to be used inside, despite all the issues that come with it, but a barbecue is going to be even worse.
Yes, to a certain extent. The problem with the gas heaters is that they've actually been banned in many parts of the world for the very reasons I've just talked about. And while some people are obliged to use them, you do actually need to go against what we were talking about a little bit earlier. You do actually need to have some openings in your home for the gases to escape.
So this is the unflued gas heater. This is a gas heater which isn't permanently installed, that doesn't have a way of this. The gas is getting outside, isn't it? It's like the cabinet type ones you're talking about.
Those are the ones I'm talking about. The permanently flued, nice modern gas heaters that are in a lot of homes, there is nothing wrong with them. To my way of thinking, they would be second only to the heat pump as the number one form of heating in a home. They are becoming fairly widespread and there are no problems at all.
So if you want to heat your house economically, because a lot of this does come down to money, Sheila, how do the cost of different forms of heating compare?
Oh, well, the heat pump is very energy efficient, as electrical, extra electrical heating. Of course, people do have log burners, and the reality is with log burners, particularly if you've got a free firewood source, can't do better than a log burner where you can heat your home as well. But give and take, and of course there are issues around ash and burning. Our particular concern, again, and followed up here by the fire service, is people using the unflued gas burners. Sometimes they were given out, and we can understand it because it's an emergency time, and it's very good to have an emergency backup, as you know, if something happens and electricity isn't restored for some time, and people do need to keep warm. But what our energy assessors have been finding, they've gone into houses and found them burning away in children's bedrooms at the night time. And really, that is incredibly dangerous. And we've just heard about the issues that that can cause. So we do have to watch that. It could have long-term effects respiratory-wise. It could also be incredibly dangerous. So keep warm, but keep safe, I think, is our message.
Is there a message you'd give us from the health point of view, David, around heating and different ways to heat your houses and the health issues around them?
It's again re-emphasising, re-echoing what's already been said. But one of the things that we are working with the with the Community Energy Action is the identification of people that have been admitted to hospital with a respiratory condition. And last year there were 500 people we've identified that we're contacting, and with the energy action to go through free assessments of the home to basically look at the warmth and the issues sitting around the home, and to walk through, you know, what are the subsidies, what are the funding, and those elements that are available.
So you're proactively saying you guys had a bad time last winter.
Yep.
Let's work with you so this winter you don't have a grim time again.
Yep, so we're targeting the most vulnerable, and what we're going to be looking at is on an annual basis now, this is just becoming part of how we do things within Canterbury. So what we have started off with is the first 500 most vulnerable, people that we know have had a respiratory condition and those that have got themselves into some difficulty previously.
So if people are thinking they're going to get into trouble this winter, you know, they didn't go to hospital last winter, but they got sick last winter, they can ring you and you guys will try and work with them to try and look at heating, insulation solutions, and try and keep them well this winter?
Absolutely correct. And just to say, it's just a most fabulous initiative by the Canterbury District Health Board to be looking at houses and looking at that whole picture. It's absolutely incredible because we've got this great opportunity now to look at people who are particularly vulnerable and do a home energy audit of their houses. I like to think not just you have the occupational health people that help people when they come out of hospital, but Community Energy Action Trust is going in there and becoming the energy occupational people. We're making sure that houses are healthy when people are in hospital and out of hospital.
And so while it may seem so blindingly obvious, the best way to keep people out of hospital is actually to have safe, warm environments and people taking ownership of their own health. And part of that is ensuring the environments are right. So through the partnership we've got here, we're hoping to make a significant impact of helping just keep the edge off the certainly off the pressure of the hospitals.
There's some people living in pretty, you know, you hear people living in garages, living in sleepouts, you know, things going on at the moment. Some of them, you know, perhaps partly as a result of the earthquake, heating those sort of places are a lot more difficult.
It's very difficult, obviously, because of the fact that they are not insulated, a lot of those places. They have gaps, etc. And people do end up needing to just about hang around over top of the heaters that they've got. The problem with that, and I deal a lot with age concern, I know of elderly people who have been severely burnt and not even felt the burns because of the you'd understand what I'm talking about, David. The fact that the circulation isn't as good as it should be, and that is one of the things that we're very, very concerned about in those situations with people. Plus the fact that a lot of the heating and the cooking implements that are used in those situations will be open flame, and of course an open flame is a means of ignition for a fire. It's just that people, I believe, just have to be doubly careful if they're in that position to what they would normally be in their own home.
So the fire service at one stage had a program around free smoke alarm checks or free... what's the fire service's involvement there with smoke alarms?
Hasn't gone away. That check is still available. We will supply one free 10-year photoelectric smoke alarm and do a check of anybody's house who rings up on the fire service 0800 number. One of our crews will come around and will advise them of the things that should perhaps be moved, changed, and will install one of the smoke alarms.
So if I'm a 78-year-old widow, I don't have anyone else to do it, I can ring you guys up and you'll come around and you'll fit me a free smoke alarm and give me advice on anything else that you think is going to cause a fire in the house.
Very, very true. And mentioning a 78-year-old, with older people, we'd really prefer that they do ring and get a nice, handsome, young, fit fireman to come and climb up the ladder and put the smoke alarm. A lot younger than me, I've got to say, and a lot fitter. But these are the guys that can put these things up, and it really, really is frightening to think of older people climbing up ladders, trying to change batteries and change smoke alarms. Ring us. We're quite happy to come and do that for you. While we're talking about it, David was talking about people becoming injured and going to hospital. And one of the things I think I'd like to talk about is the kitchen. 33% of house fires start in kitchens. And I monitor the calls that our guys go to every week. And about three times a week, they'd go to a fire in a kitchen. And probably one in those three times, we would have somebody who's actually become injured. Either they have suffered smoke inhalation, or they've actually got burnt. And some of the things that you need to do in terms of a fire in a pot on top of a stove, the first impulse of people when they see the fire is to run in, pick the pot up and try and get it outside. And there's some horrific stories about people running into the family when they're running outside
spilling,
and falling
burning,
over.
Spilling burning oil on them.
All of those sort of things. And people become injured very, very, very quickly. There are some things that you can do. The lid of the pot that is on fire, if it is available, should be gently slid onto the top of the pot. That will cut any further air getting into the pot, and the fire will go out fairly quickly, as long as you don't lift the lid up again straight away
to check if it's still on fire.
No, yeah, exactly. As long as you don't do that, you should be okay. If you haven't got the lid for the pot itself, an oven tray certainly does exactly the same thing, or even a breadboard placed over top of the pot that's on fire will cut that fire out. Turning the oven off if you can at the wall, and then removing yourself from the room and ringing 111. I don't care if the fire is out, I'd still rather our guys came along and made doubly sure. I've heard some pretty terrible stories of people believing that they have extinguished a fire and later on in the day, the night, the fire flaring up again. So the fire service are free, don't cost anything for us to turn up. Give us a ring on 111 if you have an emergency, even if you think that the emergency is over, and our guys are really, really happy
They're
to
sitting
come.
There waiting for your call.
Like coiled springs.
A lot of this kitchen fire stuff must also just start with people being careless. I mean, we talk about putting out the fire, but it starts off with people actually just being a bit sensible, not leaving a pot, you know, with the oil in there or whatever and that's going to catch fire.
Look, very much, very true. I can recall many years ago when I was younger, my mother cooking, and she wouldn't leave the kitchen while she was cooking. Unfortunately, now we've got so many other things that are of interest to us, the television, the computer, and all these things. We will actually put a pot of oil on the stove and go away and become distracted. And it happens time and time again.
It's almost like a fundamental rule. If you leave the room and there's oil cooking, you just simply turn it off, and you can turn it back on when you come back in there. It's like almost like a...
Basically, that should be a self-imposed rule with everybody. Anything like that is flammable, even sausages and things like that are cooking on top of a stove, if you're going to leave the room, turn them off till you get back.
There's something around also with the whole thing of, you know, our need for more hot food in winter, about how we just fundamentally look after each other as a community. You know, if you've got your parents or the elderly neighbours, making sure they do come over once or twice a week and you cook them that proper hot meal. And hopefully you cook a big enough hot meal that there's some leftovers they can take away so they get heated up in the microwave.
Mm. Look, to me that's one of the most important things we can do as a community, is looking after each other. Those elderly people that may be sometimes the only decent meal they get, but it's not just the food, it's the company. It's the mental wellness, it's the sense of removing the isolation that quite a number of people are feeling and experiencing at the moment. And so when we talk about health, it is actually all of those aspects, and that's actually about living well in a community.
I think some of that is about routine as well, trying to make sure you've got a routine with that elderly person or that more vulnerable person.
Yeah, and kind of setting that up as a regular part of kind of routine during the week, something that people do look forward to, something that people engage with.
Get that slow cooker going. Mm. The rebuild stuff, you know, we've got an opportunity here as we rebuild our city to think about how we do build, you know, our houses so they're warmer and safer, and I guess we start off talking about the warmth thing.
Well, that's right. I mean, some people in the situation where the outside cladding of their houses has come off, what a good opportunity there to basically improve the thermal envelope, as it's called. In other words, put insulation around the sides. We can do the top and underneath it. For some people, they might have cathedral ceilings. Now might be the opportunity to put insulation in. For other people, maybe there wasn't access under the floor before. Now there is. What a great opportunity.
But if the cladding's only fallen off one wall of my house, does it make any difference?
Well,
insulating that wall?
That's very interesting you said that. But Beacon Pathways is a wonderful research organisation, and they've done some work on this. Yes, it does make a difference to that room, so it's well worth it for that particular bedroom.
So the way someone explained to me the other day was, if you're wearing long sleeve pants and wearing a t-shirt, you do get warm, even if you just insulate a little bit more of you. It's that sort of concept, isn't it? A pair of gloves can make a big difference.
A warm hat on your head, you know, those do make a difference.
So insulating the wall can be like putting on that pair of gloves. Just one more thing can make a big difference in making house warmer. Can I think of it that way?
Exactly. And in terms of the cost, you know, this is a great opportunity for people to do this. And research has been done on it. Of course, it has to be done the right way. But the Department of Building and Housing have given a methodology for it. So if you've got a builder who's accredited builder, he would know the correct ways to do this.
Building a new house, is there information about, you know, for some people, they're thinking about building new houses. Is their house being wrecked? What have you got there?
It is indeed. Like, there's this wonderful brochure here. Beacon Pathways have been involved in it, the Christchurch City Council, the Cafe Group, and the Christchurch Agency for Energy and Certified Building Association, and also Community Energy Action Trust. It's all about build back smarter, whether you've got a new home or you are just simply repairing your own home. These are available at the City Council, or also we have some at Community Energy Action Trust as well. And you can go online, of course, and see them. So what a great, it's got so many good ideas and things like that to really think about building back smarter when we do build. And at the moment we're working with Beacon Pathways, and we're actually doing a number of houses as well, and we are learning from this. We're putting in insulation, new heating systems as well, so we are also building back smarter.
So David, for a lot of people, despite the advice we've given today, are going to get sick this winter. You know, if the week's been dreadful and you've got no money left, what happens? I mean, for some people, going to the doctor is actually very stressful, the whole money thing.
Yeah, look, if you're not well, go and see a general practice, and they have discretionary funds there that, in terms of if cost is a barrier, that barrier will be removed. It's more important that people are accessing the right, you know, kind of the right care.
So that's pretty much across the board in Christchurch?
Yes, it is.
So when you go to the doctor, say, look, I've got real financial issues at the moment.
Yep.
And do it up front?
And do it up front. Yeah, kind of communicate with the general practice that actually there is an issue there. They will not turn you away. They will provide the care. And because what is most important for us as a city is making sure that your health is being properly looked after.
Final messages. Mark, what else should we be thinking about staying safe this winter?
Well, if the worst does happen, smoke alarms and escape plans are designed to make sure people do get out from fire. Smoke alarms in bedrooms, hallways and living areas. Sleeping recommended with your doors shut. If there is a fire, escaping by the nearest means. Letting everybody else in the property know what is occurring, having a meeting place where everybody can meet so that nobody goes back into a fire thinking somebody is still in there, and ringing 111 from a safe place. If you've got all of those things,
get out, though. You're,
get out indeed, and never go back.
Sheila, well, you've done a lot of advice, but is there anything else you can sell us to make us warmer this winter?
Well, I've told you can get the free curtains, of course, to cover your windows, but this is basically under $30, and this covers 5 windows. So particularly in Christchurch, where you've got damp and draft, it's a great opportunity. Just simply plastic kit that you can get from
cheap double glazing.
Yeah, and ring us 0800 get warm as free energy advice. So we're sitting there waiting for people.
So I actually had these on one of my old houses, the previous house, and it was great.
That's fantastic.
It stayed up for years and years. So this is another way of doing cheap insulation, isn't it? Cheap double glazing.
And for people now, we've got a situation where windows have moved, but people don't want to invest a lot of money in their houses. This is the perfect thing.
Well, I hope that's been useful for people. We're going to carry on with these occasional little panel sessions, telling you about, you know, advice for how to keep yourself well through these winters and through these other events that keep happening in our community. If you want more information, there's more information on our website, the CERA website, cera.govt.nz. There's more information on the CDHB's website, the Fire Services website, but also Community Energy Action have a good website as well. Thanks for watching.